Our guest tonight is Dawn Kuyumjin, who is the program coordinator for the UC Master Gardener Program of Alameda and Contra Costa County. So Dawn's got a presentation for us. Thank you for joining us, Dawn. Looking forward to hearing more about the Master Gardeners. You have a presentation for us. Tell us more about yourself first.
I do. Well, thank you so much to Sustainable Contra Costa for wanting to invite the UC Master Gardener Program to share our resources and a little bit about us and about the university to your audience. I'm really happy to be here tonight. My position in the Master Gardener Program is I'm the coordinator. The Master Gardener Program is a volunteer-run program, except for me. I am an employee of the University of California. And I coordinate things. I coordinate the clients with the Master Gardeners. I coordinate requests with our outreach. I coordinate questions with answers. And I do this for both Alameda and Contra Costa counties. And between the two counties, there are almost 500 volunteers. We have quite robust programming. And in my presentation tonight, I'm gonna tell you a little bit about the history of the university and how the cooperative extension came to be in the relationship with the university and the community. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we do in the Master Gardener Program and a little bit more specifically about what we do in terms of local outreach in Contra Costa County, how the Master Gardener training works, and then we'll have a little time at the end to take some of your questions. So my background, I think that was another thing that we asked.
Yeah.
I've been the coordinator for the UC Master Gardener Program since the middle of 2015. So I'm going on in my fifth year, in 2016. I joined the Master Gardener Program as a volunteer in 2015. Prior to that, I worked at UC Berkeley in the Landscape Architecture Department. Some of you may be familiar with Blake Garden. It's in Kensington. It's the teaching garden for the Landscape Architecture Department. I was one of the horticulturists there. I took care of multiple parts of the garden, from the more natural places like the Redwood Canyon to some of the formal areas with more manicured beds. I did propagation, I did irrigation. I inventoried the entire plant collection. And then I also had the great opportunity for a few years to teach plant identification and use to the landscape architecture students at UC Berkeley. And I also taught a couple graduate students, graduate seminars on climate appropriate landscape design. So really thinking about our climate, our soils, and what makes sense with Mediterranean climate and the plants that are native to places where we typically don't get rain in the summer. And this year it looks like we're not gonna get any rain in the spring either. So I'm really trying to teach people with the Cooperative Extension and the Master Gardener Program about really working with the environment. And I think it's a really wonderful opportunity to share this with people that are interested in part of Sustainable Contra Costa.
Cool, well, thank you again for joining us. So share with us your presentation.
Are you ready? Are you ready? Okay.
Absolutely.
Here we go. And slideshow. From the beginning, as they say. The very, very beginning, because as they say in Sound of Music, it's a very good place to start. So we are the Master Gardener Program, and our tagline is advice to grow by, ask us. So that's where I wanted to start with tonight. So the first thing I wanted to do was I wanted to launch a poll. So Tyler, could you bring that up?
Well, yeah, just now that you asked me that, Dawn,
Okay, this is fantastic. I was just curious about how many of you are familiar with the UC Master Gardener Program of Contra Costa County. Is this the first time you've heard of us? Maybe you've seen us at a farmer's market, or it rings a little bit of a bell. Maybe you're very familiar. Maybe you are a current Master Gardener volunteer. Maybe you were formerly with it. And then that's the first question. The second question we're going to save for later.
Yeah, it's Zoom has given me a little trouble. It says I'm on a different device and my poll is not active. So I apologize. I will work on that in the background and see if I can fix it.
One thing we have learned with Zoom is how to be adaptable and flexible.
That's for sure.
It's true.
So,
Colleen says she has launched the poll. Can everybody see it? It's question number one. It's question number one, Colleen, if you can put it up there.
Yeah. I'm only seeing the results, Tyler, so I can't give you feedback.
Results already?
Yes, now we have almost half of the people here have weighed in.
Oh, cool. All right. Well, I'm not seeing the question, but I don't mind if everybody's getting to answer.
Okay, well, we'll give it maybe another little bit of time. I don't want to, I have a lot to talk about, and I certainly want to allow enough time if people have questions. So why don't, I think I have power here, and I'm going to end the poll, and I'm going to share the results, and it looks like most of the people on the call are somewhat familiar with the Master Gardener program, or even very familiar. So that's good. I mean, one of the things that we do in our outreach is, you know, if you don't, we want to make sure that people understand what the Master Gardeners have to offer to the community. So next, let's see. I wanted to share our mission, which is to extend research-based knowledge and information on home horticulture, pest management, and sustainable landscaping practices to the residents of Contra Costa County. And so as you can see on the bottom, we have the University of California connecting through the Master Gardener program through you, to you as a resident of the county. And one of the things that I think distinguishes the Master Gardener program from other like-minded organizations is that we are an extension, extenders of the university's information, and our information that we give out is all research-based. So it is reliable and it has science backing it up. So as I mentioned in my introduction earlier, I want to talk a little bit about the overview of the program, a little bit about the history and the mission, how it works, what kind of resources that we have to offer to you and the other members of the community, a little bit about Master Gardener policies, and a little bit about the volunteer training. So who we are volunteers on behalf of the University of California. We are considered volunteer agents to help the university connect with our local community. And this is a shot that was after our tomato plant sale. Some of you or many of you may know of our tomato sale that's in the spring. It started off in Walnut Creek and we have expanded, although not this year because of COVID, expanded across the county. We've also have been able to hold sales in Antioch and also in Richmond. So anyway, it's a wonderful event. It's really fun for the Master Gardeners. It's really fun to engage with the community. And you can see how happy everybody is in this picture. So a little bit about the program history. We have what was called the Morrell Act that was signed by Lincoln in 1862 that established what are called the land grant universities. So the University of California is a land grant university, but you may be familiar with like Cornell is a land grant, Texas A&M is a land grant. And it all came out of this act in the 1860s that was signed by Lincoln. And then if you think about what's going on in 1862, you have of course the Civil War and you also have homesteaders moving across the country. And people are moving into unknown lands. They don't know about the climate. They don't know about the soils. They don't know how to farm. And so the idea with this land grant university and with what came a little bit later, the Hatch Act, was to establish agricultural experiment stations to help these new settlers be able to farm and be productive in this new westward expansion. And the key here is with the Hatch Act is useful and practical information. I'm going to come back to that in a minute. In 1914, we have another, the Smith-Lever Act, which is part of the USDA, and it established for what we now call the cooperative extension. So the cooperative extension is, again, we have backing from the United States Department of Agriculture. So that's kind of the big picture about the university. But what happened with the Master Gardener program, I wanted to go back actually to the practical information. If you think about higher education in a traditional Western European model or with say the Ivy League schools or say with the first college in the US, William and Mary in Virginia, Harvard, Yale, if you think about university education, the disciplines that were presented and were studied and were esteemed were things like the study of philosophy, the study of mathematics, the study of law, the study of divinity. These were all very intellectual pursuits. The idea with the land grant university was to focus on practical skills. So when we think about something like Texas A&M, the A&M, of course, stands for agriculture and mechanics, because it's about learning about soils, about how do you build things. So it's very practical, very hands-on, and a very strong connection with whatever is figured out at the university level is then communicated and given back to the community, whether it is with the commercial farmers or, in the case of the Master Gardener program, to county residents. So in 1972, in the Washington State Extension, the farm advisor noticed that he was getting a lot of calls from home gardeners with questions about what was going on in their home gardens. And being the one thing we can say about the cooperative extension professionals is that we are all incredibly public service oriented. And although the farm advisor in Washington State realized that he did not have the capacity to answer all the questions that were coming in from local homeowners, he realized that there was a need there. And he had the idea, along with another person in his office, to develop the Master Gardener program. And this was to have an established group of trained volunteers who would then field those questions from community members, the non-commercial clients. So that's where the Master Gardener program kind of came from. Oops, we have a duplicate here. So what I wanted to say about the land grant colleges is that we have land grant colleges in just about every state of the union. And we also have the 1890 colleges, which are the historically Black colleges, and in 1994, the establishment of the Hispanic colleges. So what's important to see about this is we really have to think about this in terms of kind of national scope. It's not just the county, it's not just the state, but we have this kind of land grant structure and extension, or in California, the cooperative extension, really across the country. And the Master Gardener program, in fact, is a national program. We are part of the Extension Master Gardener program hosted through the Extension, National Extension. And there are Master Gardener programs in every state and across Canada as well. So it's really stretching into an international program. So what is the cooperative extension and how does it fit into the university? Well, the university is vast, like the universe. And of course, I think when people think about the University of California, their first thought goes to the campuses, goes to UC Berkeley, to Davis, to UCLA. But of course, the University of California comprises many, many components. There is, of course, the Office of the President, which is in Oakland, the 10 campuses, including UCSF, the medical campus. We have 3 national laboratories, and we have what is called the Division of Agriculture and Natural Resources. Within the Division of Agriculture and Natural Resources sit 9 research and extension centers, 60 cooperative extension offices, and a variety of program state institutes and initiatives. And when we drill down into the cooperative extension, in our local county office in Contra Costa, we have our local advisors. For example, the farm advisor. We have an integrated pest management advisor. We have health and nutrition advisors. We have 4-H. We have nutrition education program, because no giant university is complete without some unpronounceable acronyms. So we have FNEP, Expanded Food Nutrition Education Program, and also within the cooperative extension, but not right now in Contra Costa, there are the California Naturalists. So next I wanted to share with you about why it's cooperative. Each of the cooperative extension offices is supported by a wide variety of institutions. We have, of course, support from the University of California, but we get support from the USDA, the National Institute of Food and Agriculture. We are generously funded by the Contra Costa Board of Supervisors through the Ag Department. My position is part in our office is funded through your County Board of Supervisors to, again, to connect the university with the county residents and with our commercial clientele as well, county governments. And then we have a number of grants, endowments, and partnerships as well. So it really is quite complex. And that is why it is the cooperative extension, because we really are a network connecting the university to many, many different agencies. Because of where we are in the state, in the Bay Area, I think a lot of people, when they think of extension, they think of the UC Berkeley extension. And we are not the UC Berkeley extension. That is a different part of the university. We are the cooperative extension, which is this very far-ranging office, which, and our physical offices are located in Concord, adjacent to the Ag Commissioner's office. So I wanted to show you this map of the state of California and just look at the dots. And it really shows you how the cooperative extension really extends throughout the state, from the mountains, rural areas, urban areas, the research stations, UC Riverside, the campuses. But in the cooperative extension in the Division of Agriculture and Natural Resources, we have over 26 volunteers that contribute over 1,000, the equivalent of 1,000 full-time workers. Over $71 million that are contributed to the public and public service. That's across the entire program. So it's really, again, it's vast. It's an enormous outreach we have with the cooperative extension. So we have another poll. And I think I have power here. I'm gonna relaunch the poll. Oh,
that's great, go for it.
I have power, I like having power. So look at, you might have to scroll down. Let's do poll number two. When was the UC Master Gardener program started in Contra Costa County? Was it started in 1974, in 1983, in 1991, or in 2004? And come on, you can do it. Take a guess. It's like the SATs. You get like a 1 in 4 chance. We have one vote so far. Be brave. Ooh, yes, they are rolling in. So I'll give it a few more seconds. And you can do it. Okay, so I will, oh yes, people are starting to feel a little bit more confident now. So I think I'm gonna go ahead and end the polling. And for the second question, the most people thought 1983, and that is correct. This program has been around for almost 40 years now.
38 years.
38 years, see, somebody can do math better than I. So
Debbie said she couldn't see the poll, so I'm not sure whether that's
see the poll.
A distribution issue. Well, we'll bring that up on your third poll.
See, we'll bring it again. We'll bring it up again. Oh, here, share results. There, can you see now?
Ah, there you go.
Go.
Cool.
And I think it takes a second for the Zoom to, for the slide to advance.
Yeah, it says attendees are now viewing the poll results. Good, okay.
Okay, so let's end. Maybe you can finish that up. And let's see what's going on here. Aha. Okay, so to go back to the program history, as I said, it started in 1972 with Washington State University. Now, in 1980, the first UC Cooperative Extension Master Gardener program was established in Riverside and Sacramento counties. It came to Contra Costa in 1983. And then in 2002, it started off as a county here, a county there. And then in 2002, it was really recognized as a statewide program. And these days we have a Master Gardener program in just about every county across the state. And as I mentioned earlier, in every state across the nation, as well as throughout Canada. This photograph is a photograph of the very first Master Gardener program graduating class in Sacramento. And you probably can tell from the hairstyles that it truly was 19. So what we do in our program, our contributions in the Master Gardener program, there have been probably, these data points are a little bit out of date because of the pandemic. We're in the process of updating our data to the 2020 statistics. These are a couple of years old. I would say probably at this point, more than 7 million volunteer hours have been donated, which is worth several hundreds of millions of dollars. And this is part of the give back with the University of California. We're a land grant university. Our mission is to connect with the public and give back. And this is one of the ways that we're able to do that is through the Master Gardener Program.
And Dawn, I just want to say here that this issue of publicly funded organizations such as the Master Gardeners or the Cooperative Extension at times can be controversial. And back in the day in the 80s, we sat through many county budget discussions around whether or not to cut Cooperative Extension and so forth. And I just want to point out that that slide that you had looking at $199 million worth of contributed value really demonstrates how effective it is to use a small amount of public funds to leverage an enormous amount of economic return to the county. And therefore, I would say that, the investment is worth it. I know that we invested $74,000 in the community gardening program, and it's been going on for literally 45 years. So, thumbs up for the extension for making a valuable economic contribution for our tax dollars.
Thank you for adding that. I grew up in Central California in a more agricultural county, and the Cooperative Extension is much more visible in an agricultural county than it is in our more urban counties. And so thank you for reminding people who may be less familiar with the Cooperative Extension about the value that we bring to the community. So we have, lots of big numbers here. As of a couple years ago, about 29,000 Master Gardener volunteers throughout the state of California have been trained since 2006. And you say, why 2006 if the program was established in, a longer time ago? And that's because our database goes back to 2006. So that's why. We currently have about 6,000 active Master Gardeners throughout the state in almost every county, and many, again, just hundreds of thousands of volunteer hours supporting our local communities. And we have our last poll. And let's see, and you may need to scroll down to question number 3, which is, you can guess here, about how many active volunteers are there in the Contra Costa program? Do you think there are about 164? 271, 325, 402, and I'll let this run for a little bit. And maybe 5 more seconds or so, and then I'll share the results. I think this polling feature is kind of a fun thing in Zoom. Okay, and I'm gonna share the results. And we had, most of the people thought we were over 300 and somebody thought, there were some people who thought we were over 400, and that is ambitious. I wish we had that many people, but we have currently 271 volunteers in the program. So we have 271 trained Master Gardener volunteers, including we have 47 members with their gold badge, which means they have contributed over 1,000 volunteer hours to the program. And we also have 16 platinum badge members who have contributed over 2,500 hours, which is really quite amazing. This picture is the graduation from our training class in Richmond at the Richmond Field Station a couple of years ago. And you can see how very happy everybody is. It's really a great, group of people. Here is an example. You may know, have seen us at the local farmers markets. This is actually at the tomato sale. We have outreach tables that we have information and literature that we were able to give out before the pandemic, and we are hoping that we will be able to slowly start re-engaging now that we're getting we're able to do more things in public. So again, the magic number 2006 is just because of our database. And so in Contra Costa County, over 300,000 volunteer outreach hours since 2006. And in 2020, even with the pandemic, we had almost 19,000 hours of volunteer time. And this, one of the things we found with the pandemic and we're still finding, is a renewed interest in home gardening and being able to connect with nature, people that either haven't gardened or maybe gardened as children with their parents or grandparents, people who are looking for gardening or things to do with their children. Think there's something very invigorating and connecting about being in nature. And even though we were, our offices were physically closed, we were still open and we were still able to connect with the public in many, many different ways last year. So as I mentioned, our mission is to extend research-based knowledge and information on home horticulture and pest management and sustainable landscape practices to all of you. And be guided by the core values in ANR strategic initiative. So the core values are, you know, we want to strive to work with integrity. We want to collaborate. Of course, cooperative extension, it's all about collaboration. Striving for excellence in community, making sure our programming is inclusive and welcoming to everybody in our county. And also always be looking to the future, wanting to innovate, being able to be responsive to community needs. And one thing I found with the Contra Costa program and the Alameda program as well, is that these are dynamic organizations. And what makes them dynamic organizations is the Master Gardener volunteers who are able to identify new areas to develop. We are always, always changing and adapting, and it keeps our programming exciting and relevant. So what drives our Master Gardener programming? It's driven by the UC Agriculture and Natural Resources strategic initiatives, which focuses on endemic and invasive pests and diseases. We want to do what we can to support healthy families and healthy communities. We want to promote sustainable food systems. We want to have sustainable natural ecosystems, as well as maintaining water quality, the quantity of our water, and water security. So those are kind of the big picture pieces that guide how we structure our outreach. So what we do within the Master Gardener program is that we utilize trained and certified volunteers at the local level. I mean, this is the great beauty of the cooperative extension. Yes, we are part of the national extension. Yes, we are part of the University of California, but it really is granular. We really want to have Master Gardener volunteers who are from all over the county, who are really familiar with community needs, with community resources, where we can support development of programming. Really to be hyper-local and really be there for our neighbors and our community. Our educational program is all based on research, and we want to address the horticulture and pest management needs, again, of non-commercial clientele. In our mission statement, it's the phrase home gardener is used, but that is just to distinguish us from commercial people that are commercial. Well, we certainly know in the Bay Area that home ownership, especially lately, is out of reach for so many residents. So it doesn't matter who you are, whether you have a pot of basil on your kitchen windowsill or you have, you know, 2 acres out in the country, we are here to answer your questions. So this UC vision has, and you know, ties in with our Master Gardener outreach. We want to support all of these things, including, you know, reducing landfill materials. We can do that by promoting and educating around home composting, around grass cycling. We want to help improve health, human health. You know, it's very interesting. In the last few years, there's been a lot of research that ties healthy soils to healthy people. Very interesting research. Do a little bit of digging on that if you find it fascinating. So by protecting our soil qualities, we are able to take better care of the environment, protect our water resources, protect from erosion, things that happen, you know, during the Depression, like the Dust Bowl, and also support, you know, healthier people in our communities. And as you know, if you're healthy, you're going to be happy, and happier people just create just a more vibrant and enjoyable life for everyone. We want to protect against invasive species, whether they be microscopic, like sudden oak death, or something a little bit bigger, for example, the nutrios on the delta, as long and things in between, scotch broom, for example, plants, you know, little critters as well. And lastly, but very important, especially in the last few years and what we're seeing with climate change, is what we can do to protect from wildland fires, especially for those who live on what's called the urban wildland interface. You know, those of you who live with homes that back into open space, really, how can we do research and share that with the communities to help protect homes from fire. Next, I'd like to share a few of the resources for all of you that are available on our statewide website. Well, first of all, I wanted to introduce, we are a statewide program. We have a statewide staff that oversees the entire program throughout the state. So again, we're part of a larger organizational structure. We have a director, marketing, training, program evaluation, and we are the only Master Gardener program in the country that has a volunteer engagement coordinator. So I like to think that this California Master Gardener program is really leading the way across the country. What's under development right now is our 2020 annual report. It will be coming out, I hope, in the next few months. And the 2018 annual report had all kinds of program statistics, impact maps about outreach throughout the county. And it was, if you go onto the statewide website, you can find a PDF if you're interested in learning a little bit more there. We have on the statewide website, the statistics, we have a listing of events, especially right now where everything is on Zoom. The statewide office is encouraging the county programs across the state to list their remote presentations. One of the things that came out of the pandemic is we would have never been having programming like this 2 years ago. And the ability to connect people remotely and have people comfortable with remote presentations has just expanded our audience and expanded the learning opportunities for everybody across the state. Who knows, there might be a program in San Diego or in Shasta County that you might find of interest, and you can just dial in via Zoom and sit in and learn things. So impacts, news, resources, how to donate. We are part of the University of California, but we don't get any direct funding from the University of California. We rely on our partner agencies, such as the county, donations from our generous donors, and also grants. I wanted to talk a second about the program evaluation. When you signed up or registered for this, there was, I think, a question about, you know, do you want to participate in a survey? And I wanted to tell you a little bit about what this is. We can talk about in our programming that, yes, we saw 10,000 people at the farmers market, or yes, we had this many visitors to our talk. But the real question is, that's really great, but like, are those people taking anything away? Is that extension model of education, is it having any impacts? When someone comes to a talk, are they going home and are they implementing that? And a few years ago, the Master Gardener program hired a program evaluation specialist to develop a survey that is to help measure that. And the way it works is that 3 months after we give a talk, the people who opt into the survey will receive a very short survey. It's like 5 minutes, asking a few questions that are tied to the presentation. And all of the surveys have the question, as a result of attending a Master Gardener presentation, are you spending more time outdoors? Because there's research from about 5 or 6 years ago, and I think we're seeing more and more of this, especially when people have been stuck at home, the importance and the emotional well-being people get from being in the garden, being in nature, whether it's a walk around the block, a walk in a local park, or just sort of watching something grow on your windowsill. It really is a restorative thing. And we are really trying to track those impacts with our community. So what I'm gonna do, I can. Okay, I'll do it later. I have an, if you opted out of that, but you're thinking I'd like to participate at the end of the presentation, I'll put another link into the chat box that will allow you to sign up for that, as well as get our newsletter if you're so interested. So here's an example of one of our program impacts. So we, for example, give talks on water conservation, on mulching, on composting. And as a result, for one of those post-talk surveys, the results we got is that 50% of our respondents are reducing their turf areas, have improved the efficiency of their sprinkler system, have gone to using drip irrigation, are using planting more appropriate plants for our climate. And this was, I thought was quite astounding, was the 100% of the respondents have reporting that they are now using mulch. And this is just, I mean, I'm kind of talking to the choir here with Sustainable Contra Costa, but we all know how valuable our water and our soil resources are. And we can see with the Master Gardener program really how we are making a difference. We have a number of general gardening resources on our statewide website, including the California Garden Web, Backyard Orchard, Integrated Pest Management. And after this program, I believe we have a handout put together with all of the links that Tyler, I believe, is going to send out to all of the participants. So you'll be able to look back and have these for your reference. We have the California Master Gardener Handbook, which you can buy through us. You can get it from Amazon, but get it through us, because when you buy it through the Master Gardener of Contra Costa website, you get a little bit of a discount, and we also get a little bit of a program contribution to our funding. It's quite comprehensive. In fact, shall I? It is quite substantial. It has chapters on just everything you need to know about gardening.
That's a tome.
Next, at the statewide level, we have all kinds of social media resources. If you are into Facebook and Twitter and Pinterest, YouTube channels, we have these at the state level, and we also have these at our Contra Costa level. And we have I have a slide on that a little bit later, and the handles and things are on this resource sheet that will be circulated after the presentation. I think one of the really important things to understand about the Master Gardener program and our volunteer outreach is that our mission is one of education, not of labor. We really are not service providers. We really want to teach people how to become better gardeners, how to identify a weed, how to identify pests, and really empower individuals in their gardening and learning. So what we do, again, is we answer home gardening questions. We serve on public education activities such as this. And I would say, you know, unpaid radio and TV appearances. In Southern California, they have a radio show once a week, which is pretty, reaches just an amazing audience. We sometimes write articles in local publications. We occasionally assist with cooperative extension advisor research. So in the Contra Costa office, the now emeritus farm advisor a few years ago saw an issue that was affecting the cherry orchards out in Brentwood. And she involved the Master Gardener programs to help with the research and data gathering for cherry buckskin disease. And through that collaboration and the help of the Master Gardener volunteers, I believe the cherry buckskin disease is not prevalent at all. It really had a very, very positive effect on the cherry growers. Another question people come to the Master Gardener program and ask is, what's the best? What's the best nursery? Where can I find the best tools? What is the best compost system? Where's the best place to purchase this? What's the best potting soil? And because we are a publicly funded organization, we're legally committed not to provide endorsements or advertisements. So we have a non-endorsement disclosures. And so although we can't tell you, yes, go to this nursery because they have fantastic stock, what we can tell you is how to select a healthy plant. So when you go to the nursery, whether it is a plant at your local grocery store, if it's at the hardware store, your local independent nursery, we can give you the skills on how to identify a healthy plant. And that's, again, that's going to empower you as a gardener, rather than this us saying, go here, this is what you need. Sometimes when we do volunteer outreach in a variety of settings, and master gardeners do are covered by the university with liability insurance. So that's a concern for sometimes. And we're covered by UC. It's a big organization. So now the fun part, I want to tell you a little bit about our local projects in Contra Costa County. So the place our program really started was with the help desk. And I like to think about this as the beating heart of our program. The Master Gardener program came to be with the idea of answering community questions. And we do have a help desk. It's currently closed because of the pandemic. It's working remotely. When we're in the office, we take phone calls. Right now, everything we're doing is via email. A trained Master Gardener volunteer will get back to you. They will research the question, and they will give you a research-based answer, not just something made up because they want to look smart. And sometimes we really can't figure it out. And when we can't figure it out, we kick it up the line. We have access to all kinds of academics and resources, researchers within the University of California. If we can't figure it out with our resources, I can then ask our urban forestry advisor or our IPM advisor, people at UC Davis or people at UC Berkeley to get an answer. And sometimes we still can't figure it out. And if we can't figure it out, we'll say, really sorry, we can't figure it out, rather than send you down the garden path, so to speak. So that is our help desk. We have Ask a Master Gardener tables. So these are tables that I had mentioned earlier that perhaps you see at the local farmers markets. We do, again, before the pandemic, you might have seen us at various, we call them single day events, like at the Smith Family Tomato Farm Festival and the Olive Festival in Lafayette and the Rosie the Riveter Festival in Richmond. These tables, we have staffed by trained Master Gardener volunteers. We have a lot of information available. People come and they ask us questions. We can often answer questions right there at the table. And if we can't, we can give you a card about how to contact the help desk. Another big part of our program is community education. These two photos are from our Fall for Plants sale from a couple years ago. We call it Fall for Plants, but it really is an all-day workshop with all kinds of things about gardening sustainably. On the left, you see two people that just can hardly decide because there are so many choices of workshops to go to on that day. And on the right-hand side, this was a demonstration, a lecture demonstration on drip irrigation. We also have our speakers bureau, and we now have, because of the pandemic, this is one of the good things that came out of the pandemic, we have a YouTube channel, and we record all of our presentations. So if you go to our YouTube channel, you can find, for example, this recording that was done with the Contra Costa Library, Soil in Your Home Garden, that was a couple months ago. And we're also now starting to do some short videos on demand. We have one now on how to grow sweet potatoes. It's about 20 minutes long. It's really fun. And I believe we just posted one on how to grow potatoes in your home garden. So again, lots of great resources from our Contra Costa Master Gardener program. One of the things that we've been really working on a lot in the last few years that I'm very excited about is what we're calling our Growing Gardeners program. And to kind of demonstrate the collaboration between the different counties, this project was actually launched in Los Angeles County with a different name, and they won a statewide award for it, and they very generously shared their foundational materials with Contra Costa. And we developed it into what we call the Growing Gardeners Program. This is a public education program. It's a four-week workshop. It originally was an in-person with hands-on component, but we of course have pivoted to remote delivery now. So it's a 12-hour workshop, 3 hours, four times, with 12 units on basic vegetable growing. And we just a week ago finished finished our pilot of Jardineros en el Huerta. So we're now offering this course to our Spanish-speaking community as well. So it fills up incredibly quickly. It's like trying to get concert tickets to the Rolling Stones. We are working on being able to develop, to have more volunteers so we can offer it more frequently. So this is another one of our educational outreach programs. We also support school and community gardens. Now, master gardeners, our primary audience is the adult gardener. We don't work with children. We work with the cooperative extension work with youth is through 4-H. So what we do at our school gardens program is that we mentor and we do teacher training workshops and mentor adults that help take care of the school gardens. Again, we're educators, we're not laborers. One of the challenges with school gardens is, you know, who takes care of them during the summer, but we can train people on how to set up their irrigation. We also do a lot of work in community gardens. This shot is from the Mira Vista Senior Center, where we have Master Gardener volunteers, again, pre-pandemic, that would go on a regular basis and do seed starting workshops and help this residents with their shared garden spaces. We also work in this community gardens program. We have a regular presence at the Veterans Administration in Martinez. We have a really nice relationship with the Contra Costa County alcohol and other drugs in the residential treatment facilities that have garden education as part of their residence. So again, we're out in the community in many, many, I think we have 19 sites that we support through the community gardens program, and I think about 30 schools. Many of you may be familiar with the demonstration gardens. We have our garden in Walnut Creek. That's where this picture is. This is a shot of our training class learning about keeping trees small in the fruit orchard. In Richmond, we have a dry garden showcasing the climate appropriate plants. And we also have our Rivertown garden in Antioch at the fairgrounds. It's focused on edibles. It's a small garden, but it's really quite lovely spaces. Again, we will be open, I hope, by the time we're back into the yellow tier. And you can go when the gardens are open, stroll, ask questions of the Master Gardener volunteers, see what's going on, and sort of see how you can apply that to your situation. We also have our website, all kinds of resources there. So encourage you, if you're not familiar with it, to go there. A lot on sustainable gardening, which I know is close to the heart of this audience. We have a blog that you can subscribe to. And we have an external newsletter that goes out several times a year that you can subscribe to as well. And then, of course, the last part of our Master Gardener outreach is how we train the new Master Gardener volunteers. So we have a training class. We did not offer one last year because of the pandemic, but generally in Contra Costa County, we offer an annual training class. This year, it's going to be offered virtually. We are in the process of restructuring the entire class to go onto a virtual platform. In the past, it's been a 17-week class of about 6 hours a day. That's way too much to do on Zoom. And we cover topics from soils to home horticulture to integrated pest management, and also introduce how we interact and engage with the public. So that's a little bit about how our volunteer training works. And once you, for people who join the program and undergo the training, this is kind of a cute graphic. The application is planting the seed, and then 17 weeks of training, get your graduation and your certification. And as I mentioned, this is a volunteer program. So there is a volunteer commitment. And in the first year, there is a requirement of a minimum of 50 hours of volunteer time in support of our outreach. And then after that, the volunteer commitment is 25 hours per year with an additional 12 hours of continuing education. One of the things that we find about the Master Gardener program and the people that are drawn to the Master Gardener program are people that are really interested in learning. And we want to keep our program relevant. We want to keep our Master Gardener volunteers conversant with the most current research. We kind of force them to do it by offering continuing education. And we sponsor a lot of those events internally by bringing UC researchers, UC advisors to come and give talks for advanced training for the Master Gardeners. at 1,000 hours, Master Gardeners are honored with a gold badge. And as I mentioned, at 2,500 hours, they get a platinum badge. And that is really quite a significant achievement. So I hope that you enjoyed the program today to learn a little bit about the history, the mission, what we do in the program. And in closing, I just wanted to say that we, Master Gardeners, the Master Gardeners are detectives and teachers. We don't expect anyone to have all the answers, but what we strive for in our training program is to have the Master Gardener volunteers. You're not going to be an expert, but we really want to teach people how to utilize the UC resources to be able to extend research-based knowledge to our community members. So with that, I'm gonna wrap it up, and I just wanted to do we promised in the thing a sneak peek. Our next talk is gonna be in about a month, and it's gonna be in collaboration with the Contra Costa Libraries, and it's going to be on a very, very important and popular topic of composting and vermiculture for home gardeners. So I hope your interest is piqued and you'll be able to join that presentation. And if not, it will be recorded and posted on our YouTube channel for people to view later. Here's a list of our upcoming webinars for the rest of the year. You can see we have all kinds of things. We have gardening in small spaces, about water, about seeds, about winter gardening. I think for growing vegetables, it is a lot easier to grow in the winter because that's when it's rainy. Cover crops, garden critters, what about weeds? All kinds of things. And these programs are all offered to the community free of charge. This is part of the give back of the university to the community. So we have lots of resources here. And as I said, this will be on that handout that will be given to you, shared with you after the presentation. And I hope when I stop my screen share, I will put the link to the survey if you would like to help us serve you better to participate. And there's also a link to sign up for our newsletter if you would like to do that too. So with that, I think I will stop the share and we will go back to our group.
Great. Thank you, Dawn. That was amazing. Very, very, very informative.
Yeah,
and good stuff. And we have a question right here from Nikki asking, are there prerequisites to qualify for being a master gardener or at least attending the training?
So, you know, it seems like we would want people who are expert gardeners, but actually what we want are people who really are engaged in the community. My predecessor in this position, she had a great line, which is, we can put the gardener in the volunteer. It's a little harder to put the volunteer into the gardener. And so what we're really looking for are people that are interested in excited about teaching, excited about learning in the community and engaging with the community. And the needs of the program shift over the years. One year we have really developed our social media presence, but a few years ago, we really were looking for people that had social media skills because that's an area that we wanted to grow. This year, I think what we're looking for are people with technical skills to develop more of this kind of online. I think even after the pandemic, we are not going to end remote programming. I think people have gotten very comfortable and, you know, if you can get this kind of programming from the comfort of your home rather than having to fight traffic across the county in your car and no place to park, why would you do that? Now, I will say as a presenter, it's way more fun for me to present to a live audience. I have better engagement. I can see what's going on, but as a participant, I love Zoom. I think it's really fantastic. We also really want to expand our Spanish language outreach as well. We're always looking for writers. There's so many different ways to engage with the program. So we're not looking for somebody with a PhD in horticulture. We're really looking for somebody who wants to give back to the community. And in our program, We have people that do not have high school, who only have a high school education, that do not have higher education degrees. And we have people with doctorates. I mean, we have a really wide array of education levels, as well as a wide, and we want to have our program and our master gardeners be representative of the county. I mentioned earlier the idea of having it be hyper-local. We want people who live in Crockett. We want people who live in Knightson. We want people who live in San Ramon, in Walnut Creek, in Orinda, in El Cerrito, in Kensington, in El Sobrante, in San Pablo, in Martinez. We want master gardeners all over the county.
Good. Well, and you're reinforcing the fact that, you know, you don't need a degree and or a degree in a particularly focused topic, like, you know, biology or something like that. And I know that from my experience, from a personality type, the folks that, you know, are willing to sit at the desk, take one-on-one phone calls, that's available, doing research, you know, for people who are maybe more introverted, whatever. And then there's, you know, going out, giving presentations and being at the farmer market, much more of a public exposure. There's a place for everyone. That's the key.
Absolutely.
The other thing I found in I attended many of those early sessions is that it doesn't assume prior knowledge. You know, you come to those classes and they really take you from beginning through. So, you know, you're in the same position as everybody else in the class. So it's a very well-structured program. Go ahead.
What I find is that we have our group or our new volunteers, and we have a wide, we want to draw from a wide pool. But I said, we want to be fully representative of all the different situations in the county, from apartment dwellers to the suburban, to the more rural dwellers, to the people that are, you know, the whole wide range of demographics. And we have everyone introduce themselves at the beginning. And some people come with a lot of gardening experience. Some people really come from a community service point of view. But no matter where people start with at the end of the program, even people who I said, you know, you come, you think you have this much knowledge, and by the end of the program, your knowledge is actually expanded, but you feel like you have this much, because I think the more you learn about anything, the more you realize there is to learn. And we want to keep those doors open for everybody in the program.
Cool. Well, thanks for that. I'm going to take you in another direction here with a couple of questions. And the first one, which is the one that we get asked all the time, it comes up with respect to master gardeners all the time, is what's the relationship between the master gardeners and the word organic?
Oh, okay. So the master gardeners are part of the universe. Okay, so let's define, can you give me?
Well, okay, so.
Organic, I don't think you're meaning carbon rings.
No. Okay, so putting it in context, back in the day, I literally came within that close of being fired for using the word organic in a public presentation under cooperative extension. And, you know, it was all about the fact that at that time, organic gardening practices were not university approved, nor was there sufficient research to support recommendations of, say, no pest gardening or, you know, sheet mulching or so forth to, you know, the whole nine yards. It was pretty much pesticides and herbicides is the way to go. Now, since the 80s, there's been a growing awareness of, you know, the impacts of those. And I'm just looking to catch up on the state of the controversy, and the rest of this is, you know, the word organic these days is also tied in with the concept of permaculture, which we've taught, and John and Marion are going to join us next month to talk about permaculture gardening, and no-till gardening, and now the new and hip and groovy concept of regenerative gardening, regenerative agriculture. So bundling all those together, how do you perceive the intermingling of those, the tension between the two concepts at this present time?
Right. So I think when people think of the word organic, I think they think no chemicals, no pesticides, no chemical fertilizers. And the University of California, we teach, we give information, we don't give recommendations. And I think the most important thing to realize is that we always recommend the lightest touch. And I talked a little bit about, maybe I didn't, we have something called integrated pest management. Mm-hmm. And this is a three-pronged approach where you're looking at the environmental factors, the cultural factors. Sometimes you just can't get rid of a pest without chemicals, and that is a personal decision of whether somebody wants to pursue that. It's one thing when the squirrels are cute, you know, running around in your backyard, and another thing when you go out and all of your apricots have been eaten. Or one thing to have mice outside and another thing to have open your dog food bag only to have a rat running around in it, then that kind of changes your perspective sometimes. So what we do is we really want to encourage people to choose the least toxic means, go for cultural exclusionary, you know, like if you have birds, net them, or, you know, can you keep the cabbage moths from eating your broccoli by maybe putting a cover over it rather than spraying? We really, really want to promote what least toxic practices. And still, one of the most common questions we get at our help desk is, something's eating my plants, what do I spray?
Right.
And what we want to do is let's figure out what the problem is, right? Because if you don't know what the problem is, you can't address it. And so we ask a lot of diagnostic questions about, who knows? Maybe your dog was chomping on your zinnias and then you spray it. And then, you know, like what's the target? My dog chomps on my zinnias. So I have a lot of experience in this.
There's also lack of nutrients, you know, weaker plant will attract the pests that munch on the plants.
And there's also making the right plant selection for mm-hmm. your particular situation. So we really, I would say the word that we're using now that I think embraces more generally the idea of organic is sustainable. We really want to have sustainable landscapes, sustainable urban ecosystems. And, you know, we want to encourage people to really think twice about what's going down their storm drains, to really think about, can you have a little watershed? Can you capture the rainwater coming off of your gutters, coming off of your roof, slow it down and sink it? One thing I see a lot is people, for example, washing their cars. I think it's often, you know, we wash the cars on Saturday, but you really, we should, this is a little outside the context, but it's within water resources. When you wash your car, you're taking all of the grime that your car has picked up off of the road and it's going into the storm drain. And I live on the west side of the hills and our storm drains go right to the bay. So what's happening is all of the soap or whatever that you may be using for cleaning your car, plus all of the oil, lead and stuff that's on the highway that's getting picked up, that's all washing down into the bay. I will say the bay is much cleaner than it was about 40 years ago through public education. It's the same thing with pesticides, though, and fertilizers. The worst offenders for pesticides and fertilizer uses are the homeowners. It's actually not the ag people. The ag crops are all regulated. That's the homeowners that are not regulated. And you can go to Home Depot or it's your local retailer and you'll see just huge arrays of pesticides and rodenticides and this. And now what's really a little bit, I think we have an article in our latest newsletter about this, that there are classes of rodenticides that are now banned in California. However, they're not banned in other states.
Right.
Can order them online and they can still get shipped to California because there's not a lot of oversight. So really part of the mission that we have with the Master Gardeners and with the Cooperative Extension is really to educate people on best practices for pest prevention, which of course prevention is always better than eradication. For things like things with legs, four of them, like rats and gophers and squirrels, mice, if you trap something, if you live trap something, a raccoon, a mouse, a squirrel, you may not relocate it. That is against the law.
Yeah, we had someone from the Lindsay Museum in our last show talk about the whole urban wildlife situation, and she underscored that how to live cooperatively with raccoons and skunks and possums.
Exactly,
and so forth.
So, and yeah, that's cool. why right in alignment with our mission. So back to the idea of organic, we want to take good care of the soil. It's interesting at, I was talking about how dynamic this organization is, about how the volunteers and how we adapt over the years. With the establishment of the demonstration garden in Walnut Creek back in 2012, at that time, the practice was double digging. And if anybody has ever double dug a bed, you do it once and you never do it again because it is so much work. And this practice is you take your spade or your shovel, you lift out one scoop of dirt, you put it to the side, you lift up another scoop of dirt. So now you've gone down two shovel things, you flip it over, add amendments, and then you do this. It's a huge amount of work. It's really good if you want to get in shape. Who needs a gym membership? But what we have learned over the years is that there is a very, very dynamic, microscopic ecosystem within the soil food web that is microorganisms, it's nematodes, it's earthworms, it is moles and gophers, microorganisms, bacteria, viruses, all of these things. And when you disturb the soil and fungal networks, when you disturb the soil by digging or by tilling, you disrupt those systems. And so there's been a move to doing, taking care of the soil in a less disruptive way. And so what has happened at the garden in Walnut Creek, it started off being double dug because that was thought to be best practices 8-10 years ago. But over the last few years, they have been moving towards doing more cover cropping, doing more composting in place. They used to loosen their beds with a broad fork, but now the beds are in really good shape. And the last couple of years, they've done cover crops and they cut down the crops. They don't even pull things out. They leave the roots in the soil because those roots help aerate. Then they break down and leave channels for pore space for water and air. And so again, we are always learning, we're always adapting, we're trying new things, again, for a more sustainable and verdant world.
Good. Well, it sounds like there's quite a bit more of alignment. So it's no longer quite the contentious environment that it was 40 years ago. So let me take a minute and open it up to questions from the audience. Raise your hand or just speak up. Everybody, and if you're muted, Tyler, go ahead and unmute people.
Yeah, you can. Folks can unmute themselves now, but we also have the Zoom has the hand raise feature.
Yeah,
if you'd like to use that.
So, and I'll count.
We did. We did have that question from someone about the number of hours per year. She said, "Is there a requirement commitment for volunteers to do?" Their hours is there a time limit per year?
Right.
Answer that one. I was paying attention. It's 25 hours a year, right?
That is correct. 25
plus
hours.
12 hours of continuing education, right?
We run on a fiscal year. So we run from July 1st to June 30th in our training class. The training class usually ends, I forgot to put this slide up about the tomato sale. I should do that.
You should do that. That's a big deal.
Our training class usually ends in February or March in time to help prep for the tomato sale. And then the 50 hours is not due the next June. That's not really a year. So for what we call the first year master gardeners, they have actually a little over a year to complete their 50 hours of volunteer time. So let me go back to the screen share. And where did it go? Oh, my goodness. I will go back to this slide. And well, I'm just going to be incompetent here. So our tomato plant sale, if you go to our website, there is a listing of all our tomatoes. It's going to be an order online pickup, schedule a time to pick up. The volunteers will schedule that, and payment is by cash or check. We have thousands and thousands and thousands of plants that are being propagated right now. And this year, again, because of the limitations of the pandemic, the sale will only be in Walnut Creek. Plants are $4 each, and that is our main fundraiser for our Master Gardener program. People say, you know, what do you, you know, like, what do you use the money for? Well, what we use the money for is, well, when we're in person, we want our programming available to people all over the county. Our offices are in Concord, and we have conference room space there, but that's not necessarily convenient for people. So we often will hire a venue for presentations. In our community gardens, we often will purchase materials for a demonstration or for a workshop, how to build a raised bed, for example, the programming materials. And then there are all of those things that, you know, you don't see, like the constant contact payment and printing and binders and books and licenses and things. So it's a quite robust program, but it is that tomato sale that has enabled the Contra Costa program to grow and be incredibly successful and have a lot of impact in the community.
Cool. Well, I'm not seeing a whole lot of questions from the audience. And we're after 8 o'clock at this point. Last call for questions. I'm not seeing any. Well, at this point, then I'd like to thank you, Don, for sharing all that valuable information with us. Congratulations on the, you know, your role and the success of the Master Gardeners in our county. Like I said, it's an institution that we all should be proud of and doing great things in our community. So I encourage all of you to consider volunteering or referring people to the Master Gardeners or taking advantage of the services in terms of what's on my plant or how do I grow X or Y or Z, because they're available and that's what they do. So look for them at the farmer's market once we're back to the end time or the before times again.
Where being together again.
Right.
I just want to give a big thank you to Sustainable Contra Costa for inviting me to present on behalf of the program. And it's been a pleasure.
Our pleasure. Thank you. So with that, I'd like to introduce Tyler to give us the sustainability tip of the month.
All right. Well, look at that. What's that? What a coincidence. And I swear to you, we did not talk to Dawn beforehand.
Oh.
She was giving you a sneak peek of the Master Gardeners webinar. I think it was April 20th, right, Dawn?
That's correct.
Which is all about composting. And the action for this month is compost. And these actions, by the way, are always taken from the Cleaner Contra Costa Challenge. You can see the website at the bottom there. That's where you get all the fabulous resources, instructions, links, even rebates in some cases for how to do the various things that will reduce your carbon footprint. And if you are creating your own fertilizer and putting it on your vegetables, that is a significant reduction in your carbon footprint. The cool thing is you get some amazing fertilizer that you made yourself in the process. So whether or not you're worried about your footprint, everybody should be composting. And just pointing out that up to 30% of our waste can be composted. It is a very rich fertilizer. I mean, it's literally what your plants evolved to live on, decomposing organic material. It doesn't smell really, and it is easy. So there's lots of resources. I was looking at the UC Master Gardener Program website, and they have some great tips under their sustainable gardening section. So check that out. But also our waste folks here in Central County, Recycle Smart, have tremendous resources, including really steep discounts on various kinds of compost bins, just the regular backyard bins and also the ones that do the worms. Worm composting is fun. My daughter lives in an apartment, so she's got a little worm box that we're getting her set up with. Everybody can do some kind of composting. So check this out. And if you have not joined the Cleaner Contra Costa Challenge yet, please do so. It's cleanercontracosta.org. Oops, I just went backwards. And you can find all the resources there for a wide variety of actions. So that is your sustainability tip of the month.
Cool. Well, thank you, Tyler. And now, Colleen will present our upcoming schedule of events.
So before we get on to the events, we ask you to take just a moment when the program is over to complete a brief survey about tonight's program to help us improve our offerings. You can go to sustainablecoco.org/TV for the survey. That link is in the chat. And we thank you ahead of time for your participation. I'm also excited to share that we have some great prizes available that you can earn by even participating in the challenge and completing one action. For example, you can get a free yard of mulch from EcoMulch. If you haven't heard of EcoMulch, I would highly suggest checking them out. They take waste materials from tree projects throughout the Bay Area and turn them into beautiful mulch for your garden. They also have compost available. And you can also enter drawings to win gift cards from the businesses you see listed on the screen. And those can help you get a head start on your spring gardening. You can visit sustainablecoco.org/challengeprizes for details. We do have two events in April you can keep your eye out for. The next episode of Sustainability Live will be on April 28th. Broadcast live from the Rogers Ranch Urban Farm, and our youth team's Climate Careers Chat will be on April 29th. This event will feature an interactive panel with industry professionals in sustainability. You can find details on all of this and more at sustainablecoco.org.
Cool. Well, and before I have Tyler give us some information about the upcoming, or how we can look at this particular show, I want to mention the upcoming shows. We have a great show coming up in April with John and Marion from Rogers Ranch. That'll be the fourth Wednesday of the month in April.
28th.
We also, the 28th. We also have the Mount Diablo Beekeepers coming to talk about beekeeping. And that's going to be fun because I think we're going to have a demonstration hive and so forth. And that the Mount Diablo Beekeepers is a program that grew out of our work at Eco House back in the late 70s, in fact, and they're still going strong after all these years. Then we are also going to have the current or potentially former director of the Cooperative Extension in Contra Costa, Rob Benetton. Don, is he still, because I know he was shifting his role or something like that?
He is now the Urban Ag Advisor for five Bay Area counties.
Exactly, right. And so we're going to have Rob come and talk about urban agriculture, which is an amazing topic for the times. And then coming up in, July, we're going to be having a focus on urban bicycling and talking about our bike trails and all the issues around getting around on alternative transportation. And then what did we decide for August, Tyler?
Oh, we were looking at fire safety, and we were looking at...
No, there was another one. Anyway, well, that got us through July.
it's coming along. Stay tuned.
Yeah, right. It was a good one. So,
and if you're not subscribed to our newsletter, you'll get an opportunity to do that in the follow-up email that I should be able to send out tomorrow, if all goes well.
Well, tell us how we can...
That's where you'll hear all that. Yeah, so I'm throwing up the Master Gardener's website one more time. Dawn put it on her slideshow, but make sure you've got it. Not only their email there, they are taking help desk questions only by email right now. And then the website with a tremendous number of resources. You can really have fun drilling down into that website. But you can also find us in lots of different places. And this program that you heard tonight will be saved and shown on our YouTube channel. Should be up by tomorrow sometime. So you can share it with folks who weren't able to be here tonight or watch it again if you want. And we are all over the place on social media, Facebook, Instagram, et cetera. And remember to sign up for the challenge at cleanercontracosta.org. Cool. So Colleen has our closing credits.
Yes, Colleen.
This has been Sustainability Live, a production of Sustainable Contra Costa, presented as part of our community education and outreach program. Our goals for this show are to provide you with useful and timely information about all aspects of living sustainably, guided by the 10 One Planet Living Principles, and to provide an online community for sharing information and learning together. I'd like to thank our generous sponsors, Central San, Mount Diablo Resource Recovery, Contra Costa Green Business Program, MCE, the cities of Antioch, Pittsburgh, Martinez, Moraga, Pleasant Hill, and Walnut Creek, Republic Services, Contra Costa Water District, EcoMulch, Recycle Smart, and the Contra Costa Center Transit Village. Finally, I'd like to thank tonight's volunteer crew, producer Gotham Sathasan, director and host Mark Westwind, and technical director Tyler Snordum Phelps. For more information about One Planet Living and all of Sustainable Contra Costa's programs, activities, and special events, please visit our website at sustainablecoco.org. Finally, your support is always welcome. You can also make a donation on our website.
Great.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you all.
Have a great night.
See you next time. Good night.